you're glad to be in the house tonight. He is a good God. Amen. And for those watching out on Facebook and YouTube, where it is tonight, here it's cold and snowy, but we thank the Lord. He's blessed us, warmth in our hearts, and it is warm in here. We praise the Lord for that. We know there's needs out there, though. We do mention some folks. Sister Ruth, if you're watching, we're praying. Brother Woody, we're praying. Several others, so many others, we're praying and believing for you. Let us know you're watching. Always love to hear from you. And we're looking forward to what God's going to do in our time tonight. I did want to sing this song. This is a song off of CD. But I do want to invite the Lord's presence. As many know, my mom and Andrea, she's going through some things. And when you go through stuff, sometimes it can, if we don't careful, we can let our minds roll. We need the presence of the Lord to refocus us where we need to be. We need His presence. And so whenever you're ready, number 12 on there. Can you just worship the Lord tonight? We'll have the words up on the screen. Whether you know it or not, can you give this time to the Lord and just invite His presence? Lord, we do. We invite Your presence in this church tonight, in this house tonight where we have gathered to give You praise. You have brought us safely. How can we ever thank You for all that You've done, Lord? Thank You.
Spirit of the Sovereign Lord, come and make Your presence known.
Let the weight of Your glory fall.
Procedure tomorrow, and I'm thankful you guys get to be there, I think, and we're believing for good for this. Appreciate your prayers with us. God, He has this. I was telling somebody else in another situation here in the church, it doesn't sometimes look like it, but He's got it. He's got what's going on. Come on up here, Molly. God bless you.
Excuse me, Molly. Bring your mic with you. I think it moved.
Uh-oh. Thank y'all for working on it. Dave and Jamie, if you're watching out there too, over there, we love you. We pray God's blessings for you. Pastor Jeff, so many others. Our sister Opal, we're praying for you. I'm praying for your family too. God bless everybody out there.
Like a fire.
To them, if any, now this is a little off the cuff, but we're going to door to baptism at some point soon as the weather improves. And praise God, I've already got one that's wanting, and we want to check out and see if there's some others. And we're going to look and see if we can't get us a date coming up here soon for some baptism. And it's always exciting. So keep that in mind. We do have mentioned the discipleship is next with Gary and Ruth, February the 2nd, Hebrews chapters 1 through 4. The nursing home is this coming Sunday, as the weather permits, and I'll mention that too. We know some weather's coming in, so we don't know about Sunday how it'll be. If we can have it, we'll see what we can do. My plan in my head, this is just in my head, with a few days to go, we might be able to get some enterprising young whippersnappers from our church that have done it in the past, do a little shuffling for us, Jane and Keith. And some of those out there, they've done it in the past. We'll see if they maybe can do it again and shovel us out where we can have church on Sunday. But we'll get back and see how things look and make sure to let everybody know. And if possible, we'll be at the nursing home. This is our nursing home Sunday, this coming Sunday afternoon at 3. So we invite everybody. And we will not be here Sunday night, whether or not. So we won't be here then. So the ladies' study we'll mention again is next Friday. Hopefully you'll have much better the conditions out there on the roads, and it will be set up to share. And I believe it may be my wife that's going this time to share, but I'm not sure. So we will get back to you on that. But it should be a great time in the Lord. All right. Well, I've had my family in for the last little bit, and I appreciate some different folks sharing for us. And so we've been in 1 Corinthians. I want to continue there in 1 Corinthians because there's a lot of good stuff that we can dig in. A lot of important stuff in these chapters. And we're in chapter 15 tonight, if you're following along in 1 Corinthians. This chapter is well known as the chapter on the resurrection. And it's got a lot of different things. We're not going to talk about that just tonight by itself. We will hit that a little bit more in some weeks to come. But we're definitely going to talk about that some tonight. And some other things. And I call this tonight proofs. Proofs. We need to see that proof come. And we live in an age and a generation that we need to see that proof. And I'm thankful that the Lord doesn't leave us alone, but He gives good proof that He is with us. And He has done amazing things and will do amazing things. And so I want to read some verses here, and then we're going to dig into this tonight. And I'm going to read here for us the first two verses for us, sister. Okay? And then we will pray. The Bible says, 1 Corinthians 15, 1, "Moreover, brethren, I declare to you that the gospel which I preached to you, which also you received, and in which you stand, by which you also are saved, if you hold fast that word which I preached to you, unless you believed in vain. Father God, we believe your word is true tonight,
yes.
And we stand on this. We are here, dear God, to see your word act, to become active, dear God. You will prove yourself as we trust you, And we just ask that your word come into our lives and do exactly what it needs to do so that others might see as well, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. So, we, as people, just as people, we don't naturally trust. We like to have proof. We want to have that. I remember I went to school in the fifth grade in a little town called Lafayette, Tennessee, if you've ever heard of that. It was a small town, but it was in the fifth grade class I was in. It seemed like every boy would like to tell stories. Maybe that was just the age that they did. And they would tell the wildest stories about Bloody Mary, or the wildest stories about what they did and all the karate that they knew. And it's like, eventually it came down to a point for me that you have to say, prove it, kid, prove it. You know, and I know you try to trap them and try to catch them in it. Yeah, all these stories you're telling me. And it's how it is as kids for us, and it continues on. And many in the world, they live in a world like that where they've heard stories all their life that are just not true. And so truth, and indeed it is hard to come by. You know, we look out in the world of politics or the new technology emerging, the AI, it makes things look real that are not. They look very good. If you ever see some of those videos, they look very close, but they're not the truth. They're not real. You can't prove anything from those. And even though some of the details have changed, people are the same, right? We still have a need to see that proof. We have a tendency so oftentimes for deception as people. And in Corinth, we talked about it, it was a very materialistic town. It was a sea town, coast town, and people would come in from all over, and they had trouble. This church did, and believe it. Did Jesus really rise from the dead? Did that really happen? Because, you know, it's not something that we can see. It's not something that you can necessarily prove in the normal way. And they believed, like so many do today, that seeing is believing. Anybody know what I'm talking about? We have that attitude. But I encourage us that we can trust the Lord has risen from the dead. And as we trust, believing is then seeing for us. And we'll talk about how do we do that? How do we see our faith? Because we don't believe in vain, as it says here. That's not what it has for us. We have good reasons for what we believed, and we have to stand in those. And so what these opening verses are saying here in this chapter is that we need to stand firm in our faith. Because if we don't, how in the earth is anybody else out there going to? And so Lord, help us as the church that we will take a stand, because it hasn't always been the case that we will be firm and say, hey, I'm going to hang on to this, that I know some things are true, and I'm not going to let anything stop me. And then when we have that conviction, it's amazing what the Lord can use us for to minister to somebody else that doesn't have that same conviction, or their faith is weaker. And so we don't have to have that our faith wreck, as it says here. We don't have to have that. We can see our faith grow. And so I want to look at some reasoning here. We have proofs for our faith. And Paul wrote to the church that they had to stand, and they had to depend on faith, not just from before, but for today. There's a lot of people, as sad as it is, they have faith, and then their faith drifts. It wanders, and it's not what it used to be. But it doesn't happen. We don't have to depend on, we can't depend on yesterday's faith. We can't depend, and this is a little bit of an aside, but it is a preach. We can't depend on anybody else's faith either. I can't depend on mom's faith or spouse's faith or the pastor's faith. We can't depend on anybody else. It has to be the faith we have today. And that's what the word says here, that we are saved by that as we hold fast to that and let it grow in us. And so I want to encourage us tonight that we have good reason for what we believe, and we need to hold on to those reasons. Well, why do we do that? How do we have that? The scriptures tell us here that we have reasoning. Because he's telling this church, hey, I know that where you are, it's a rough place to believe, but we still have every reason to believe. And in verses 3 and 4, we're going to read here, Paul begins to write in and say, here's what's going on. Here's why we believe what's going on. All the good doctrines that we have faith in, we have proof for. Verse 3, the Bible says this, "For I deliver to you first of all that which I also received, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures." Verse 4, "And that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to the Scriptures." And so I want to stop there. It says here, first of all, in verse 3, these are basic. Well, that's what Paul's saying here is these are basic things. We're not going to negotiate with this. This is something, we lay this down, and this is not going to be something that we go away from, even though some try to in the faith in the church. And the scriptures here that are being talked about here are primarily, not exclusively, but primarily the Old Testament. So looking at the Old Testament, how that the Old Testament talked about hundreds of years, in some cases further than that, way back, it talked about the very things that happened to Jesus, that he would die, that he would rise again. You look in Psalms 22, you look in Isaiah 53, you look in those passages long before Jesus died, there he is in the scriptures, having done so and risen again. And we see that in the Old Testament, what would happen. And so we understand in the scriptures that we read, sometimes we'll read through, I've talked about my wife, if she's watching tonight, hey, we read through the scriptures. Sometimes we go through a lot of those books in the Old Testament and wonder, what is that saying? What is that saying? I remember my parents would read that to me, my dad sometimes, and then my mom sometimes. They would take turns reading the scriptures to my brother and me at different points growing up. And it's like, what is that saying? But I tell you what, if we read that and we don't know, keep on going. It lays a foundation. Those scriptures lay a foundation. You may not quite get it yet, but as time goes on, just as it did explaining, you know, as time goes on, the scriptures are proved. That's true here with the Lord Jesus and what happened, that he died and rose again. The scriptures are proved. And the same thing will be true in your life and mine. As we continue on, we will have proof the Lord's there, because we will see scriptures, promises, good words in the Bible fulfilled in our lives. They're going to come to pass. And so that's something I want to really hammer home with us, that the scriptures are so critical and so important for us, and that they must be read to know the proof. Proof is not proof unless it's actually utilized and brought to bear. And we have to have that proof. I had a case I was working on for the solid waste, and it took a lot of doing to get the proof. We had some videos, and I put some cameras out, and the guy that owned the land put some deer cameras out, and we were trying to catch what was happening, and his cameras got stolen, but we got just enough footage off of it to figure out who's dumping this junk out here. And so, God works that way too. He brings out the truth as we hang in there, and as we, dig in and see what's there. And I've had to do that with cases, that particular case, but others, you're looking through picture after picture on a deer camera, because a deer camera, I found, at least the ones I've had, it'll take pictures. If there's just a little bug moving, it'll take some pictures of it. So you gotta go through picture after picture. You gotta dig through. And we had to on this sludge case we had that I was talking. But I'm thankful. God helps with that. He helps so much with his word. When we dig it out, in other words, my point I'm driving at here is when you take the time to dig it out, it is time worth it. It is not wasted. Dig it out, because the proof is in the scriptures, and we will see his word, the things that we have been taught, we will see that proved out in the scriptures. And if it's not proved out, if the scriptures don't teach it, then we need to let that go. Amen. So the proof is in the scriptures. And so we see his word gives us proof, because it's been fulfilled. And I could give other examples of that too that go beyond what it's talking about here. But we see time and again, the Bible is fulfilled. And I want to stress that to us, that we have good reason for this book, because we lay our foundation on it, and we have good reason to do that. Verses, continuing on in verses 5 through 7. So proof is in the scriptures. Proof also is in what was seen. Let's read. And that he was seen by Cephas. Cephas is another word, is another name for Peter. Then by the 12, verse 6. After that he was seen by over 500 brethren at once, of whom the greater part remain to the present, but some have fallen asleep. After that he was seen by James, then by all the apostles. And so I'm going to stop here for this point right now. Jesus was seen. He was seen. Paul writes about Many witnesses. Many witnesses. I was reading, I was thinking, they did a study in England. Which, you know, we have five senses, right? The basic five senses. Which one's the most, do people value the most? And it is true that in general, our eyes are generally the ones that people seem to value the most. Some people say hearing, but I value them all. I don't know about anybody else. I like them all, but they say the sight is that one. And it is true. The sight is very important. And so what do we see? I was thinking about that because I drive around Logan County. I see a lot of different things. I saw a lot of snow today going around. I see a lot of farms. I see a lot of Dollar General stores. I see a lot of different things that have popped up over the years that have changed here in this place. And so we see with our natural eyes, but my point is our spiritual eyes will reveal more to us if we open them up, if we allow them to. And here, and Jesus, we have proof because he was seen by witnesses. And why does Paul include these witnesses here? Well, Peter was well known as a Christian. James was the Lord's brother. Jesus' brother actually had a resurrection appearance. We don't have that in the Gospels, but it seems to have happened. He appeared specifically to James, and James ended up becoming a leader in the church. If you look in the book of Acts, it's very clear James is a leader there. And very, very well known. And so his point is that, hey, look at this. You know, you have people that they're Christians. They are very well. They say Jesus rose from the dead. They didn't say he didn't. They said he did. And it says also in verse 6, it says 500, and over 500, that they all are there. There's some of them are dead, but quite a few of them, it says they're still alive. They're going to tell you Jesus rose from the dead. He's alive. And so witnesses tell what they see. It's not too complicated. It's not too complicated here. And there are witnesses here that Jesus is alive. And we have those proofs. A lot of times this message comes up around Easter, but it's good anytime. We need a foundation for our faith and to know that we have good proof. And we have their witnesses that were willing to die for their faith. James and many other. We have from not in the Bible, but in the author Josephus, as James mentioned here, Josephus, a writer, talks about how the Jewish priests actually one took office just so he could kill James, and then he left again because he was they really gave everything, is my point, to because they believed that Jesus rose from the dead. They believed he was alive. And so these witnesses testify, and they still do. They testify to us today of the faith they believe in. And so what I'm digging in and digging out here is testimonies matter. Amen? So they matter. We understand that testimonies are not gospel necessarily, but we do understand that testimonies can make a difference. That's why we had the testimony service recently, and we've had some in the past. We give an opportunity for folks to testify at times. Why? Because I believe we overcome the Bible. The Bible says it. We overcome by our testimony, the word of our testimony and the blood of the Lamb. We overcome. And so we have a testimony that we can share, but my point is, let's take to heart other testimonies of what God has done in folks. They will lift us up and encourage us and give us further encouragement to build our faith. We serve a God who works. It's good to take stock in what God has done in others. Oh, Lord, help us. Lord, help us to trust and to see that and to have those testimonies matter to us, because there's a good testimony that's here. For the resurrection, for what Jesus did. And we're going to continue on just a little bit further, verses 8 through 10 here. And I'm going to add back in something here that came through in verse 3 as well. But let's read verses 8 through 10 first, and then if you go back to verse 3 too, sister, whenever we get through 10. Then last of all, he was seen by me, Paul, also, as one born out of due time. Verse 9. I am the least of the apostles, who am not worthy to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. Verse 10. But by the grace of God I am what I am, and his grace toward me was not in vain, but I labored all the more abundantly than they all, yet not I, but the grace of God which is before me. Thank the Lord for his amazing grace. And then back in verse 3, all the way back to verse 2, which we already read in 1 Corinthians, it says, I delivered you first of all that which I received. In the book of Galatians, Paul makes it very, very clear. He didn't get this taught by somebody to him. He received it from the Lord himself. The Lord Jesus gave him the gospel that he received. He had a divine revelation. He had the experience on the Damascus Road and apparently other experiences of Jesus. And so the church didn't have to just believe the other witnesses. Paul, his own self, the author, had seen the risen Jesus. And that's two things that I'll mention here for that, that bring along with this. Experience matters. Experience matters. Paul had a complete turnaround, if you remember in Acts 9, on the road to Damascus, he had a complete change. The Bible was very clear that Paul was a smart fellow. He knew his stuff, but until then, his wisdom had led him down. It didn't take him where he needed to go. He had to have an experience with Jesus. And one thing I've had to learn in my life, in my walk, it's not just a textbook for us, but it's really knowing who he is and experiencing God. Yes, we have to know things. Not saying that. We don't want to de-emphasize that. And sometimes you get it where schooling is de-emphasized and other things. We need to have the education. But I tell you what, we don't want to let anything take away from actually what we call the born-again experience, knowing Jesus in our hearts, being saved, growing in our faith in our hearts, not just in our heads. And so I want to encourage us, we need to let that faith grow and that experience in who the Lord is grow. And I believe we can have that with him as we seek him, as we go towards him. And not just let the knowledge of yesterday or the knowledge of maybe what so-and-so says out there. Well, so-and-so says that. No, I'm thankful today we can know him. We can understand who he is and experience our God for ourselves. Experience matters. And Paul had met Jesus. He knew who he believed in because he met him. And that's what we need to do too. We have to meet Jesus. And we have to meet him again and again and keep on going in our faith. It's not just a textbook. And I just want to encourage us too, that the Holy Spirit will prove himself time and time again in our hearts. And so we emphasize that. I have a friend who doesn't fully understand about it. And, he says, it was a funeral that he went to. It's like, all they talk about is being saved and born again and being saved. We talk about that a lot because it is important. It is important that people understand that they need to be right with the Lord. Now, we need to grow from there. Our brother talked about that the other day. But we understand that experience of being saved is so critical. There's so many folks here that know about God. They've heard about it. They heard about it in church when they were kids and drifted away. And they've not been saved. They need to be saved. And so we just stress that people need to be born again, even here in the Bible Belt. Amen? Born again. May we not lose that. We keep praying for all other ones. Don't give it up. Don't give up that experience is not for them, but as we believe for good. All right. So one other thing I said, there are two things here that with these verses. Paul was a bad man before he was saved. There's no he killed, he put in prison people that didn't deserve it. He was bad. He says that in verse 9. I'm the least. I don't even deserve any of this. I deserve nothing. But by the grace of God, it's like, I thought of Popeye saying that I am what I am. And I'm thankful it's not because of me, it's because of him, Paul says. And that's exactly the way it is true for us. By his grace, we have to realize it's all God. And some of the different folks have been sharing a little bit this year as we're getting this year going. I really feel like the Lord wants to make sure we depend on him and not ourselves this year and the time coming up ahead. It needs to be about him. Lord, help us to trust him and not ourselves. Because we always fall short when we trust just ourselves. So how is this proof? I'm thankful that God proves Jesus is alive by making the vilest sinner clean. Doesn't matter. Doesn't matter the past. Doesn't matter what it's been that's been done. He makes everyone clean that comes to him. So we have hope. We trust. We trust for those that we love. We trust for those out there that maybe we don't think so highly of. God has something for them, and believe that the Lord can take and make us clean. And it's proof of who he is because he changes hearts. He changes hearts. I love it. It was said, and I'm going to say the names because I don't want to get too much into politics. But there was a politician one time that was asked his favorite philosopher, and he said it's Christ because he changed my heart. And I think that's really awesome. It's not just about the philosophy. I'm thankful that he doesn't leave us just with the thoughts. He changes our hearts. He changes us. It doesn't matter who we are. And this particular politician had done some pretty bad things. God changed his heart. I believe he changed his heart. I believe that's true for anyone that will come to him. And so my point is that Paul experienced in his heart. He knew he didn't have to just listen to Peter or James or 500 others. He knew what God had done. And I'm thankful today we can too. We can have that proof in our hearts that there is a God, and he has sent his son to die and rise again and be in our hearts. Well, let's continue on here. Just a little bit more. I'm going to kind of wind this down here. We were ready for verse 12, sister. And even after all this, there is good proof. But the Bible says now this. Now, if Christ is preached that he has been raised from the dead, how do some among you say there is no resurrection of the dead? Even after all this, people still don't believe. Paul lays out his case. They had the case laid out. Paul spent quite a bit of time in Corinth, if you look at Acts. They still had people that really didn't believe. You may remember Matthew 28. They saw Jesus on the mountain, but it says some still doubted. Some still doubted. There's always going to be that doubt. And if we have that doubt, we can be encouraged, because I believe the Lord, he is merciful and he is gracious to those who still struggle in belief. There's an old saying that goes like this: the proof is in the pudding. Anybody ever heard that saying, the proof is in the pudding? It's actually an abbreviated old saying for the proof in the pudding is in the eating. Pudding in the old days was not like pudding, like jello pudding like we eat. It was like a big meat goulash. And the meat goulash could be kind of either ruined and kill you, or it could be really, really good. They put it all this kind of meat and blood and guts and wrap it up into like an intestine or stomach. And it was kind of gross. But it was something that really had to be sampled to prove it wasn't going to make you sick. And so that was, the proof was in the pudding, whether or not it was good or not. My point is this: people are sampling us. Did you know that? People are checking us out to see if we are the real deal. What we believe is actually true is good stuff. And my encouragement for us is we need to be ready. I encourage us that we need to let our, as this year rolls along, may we see our faith build up. May we do those things that we know will build up our faith and understand that we have proof that we should stand firm in. And that is, if, like it says, that we stand and we don't quit standing, we keep on standing, because we need to be ready for what God has, and we need to hold on to our faith. As we read down through this chapter, we're not going to cover any more of it tonight, but as you read on down through, we see in the moment and twinkling of an eye, he's coming back. And we will see everything. You talk about proof, we're going to see it. But until that day, we still have good proof in our hearts, and we need to let that shine out to people who need it. I was reading a little story about this. There was an artist. He was traveling through Europe. He was going through, and he lost his passport. I remember I had a driver's license issue lately, and I went for a prayer. I wasn't going to get on the plane. I told that story. And I read this, and it kind of brought this to mind. He was traveling through Europe, and he was going to need to cross the border into another country, but he didn't have a passport. So he's talking to the guard, because he's a famous artist. I can't remember his name. It's not important to the story. Hey, I'm this famous artist. And he says, nah, you're not this famous artist. Give me a break. Give me a break. And he says, no, I can prove it to you. And the guy says, all right, if you can draw something really good, if you can draw something out there that actually looks like this artist you're talking about being, maybe we'll let you do this. And so he goes to work, and he sketches something out, and he works, and he does the work that he knows how to do. And he shows it to the guard. He says, wow, that's pretty good. I'm going to go ahead and let you cross. I'm going to go ahead and let you cross. Even though I don't really know, I'm going to see. I see what you've done. I'm going to let you cross. I believe for us too, people may not really know us or know about us, but I tell you what, they are looking to see, not just with our words, but our actions. Do they actually prove and bear up? And I believe through the Lord working in us, if we've experienced Jesus like we talked about, people will see proof in us. As the brother said the other day, that we're the only Bible some people will ever see. And we believe they will see something good in us that they need. Your family, my family, will see something good that they need to see. When they might not say anything else or care anything else, but they see, hey, there is something different. There is proof that there's something better in you. All right. So I want to pray for us here. I want to pray for us here that the Lord will minister in what we need. For anybody out there, Jesus has proved himself time and again. And I pray that wherever you are, that you're watching this tonight, that he'll prove himself to you and that you'll give your life and surrender to him. And for all of us here, that the Lord will take us to a place where our faith and our calling will be more sure than ever. It will be more firm in our heart than it ever has been. Because we all struggle with doubt at times. And we need to see that faith grow. Let's pray. Our Father, we thank you that you have given us good gifts. You've given us good proofs that Jesus is alive and well. And Lord, even though sometimes we make mistakes and we falter, we know that you love us and that, Lord, as I was sharing with somebody, it doesn't matter what we've done. We are made in your image. And I pray for anyone that's watching this tonight, they are made in your image. And if they need to make it right, Lord Jesus, you have proved yourself to them that you are good and that you are alive. And I pray, dear God, that you prove yourself to them in the deepest place in their heart, that anyone that needs to make it right with you tonight, maybe they've served you in the past, they're not doing that now, that, Lord, you will make yourself real to them in these last days, because, Lord, the time is short. You've revealed in different ways to us that the end is near. Oh, and Lord, we just ask that you show yourself to anyone that needs to know you, and they will turn their lives to you and be right and be saved, be born again. We pray that and believe for that in Jesus' name. And Lord, I pray that for anyone that is struggling with doubt tonight, anyone that's struggling with that they need to see the risen Jesus in their life, I pray that you show yourself to them in a way, the amazing way that only you do. And that, Lord, you'll minister, yes, in every need, but most of all in that need in our hearts. And we'll have a firm experience with you, and yes, a firm intellect with you too, and an understanding that, Lord, these working together will see our faith grow. That, Lord, we will have just a foundation, a firmness, dear God, that's there from you, that the faith will grow in lives. We believe that in Jesus' name. We believe that also for Christian life, that this church will see that. Anyone out there, dear God, that's struggling, they're doubting because of some experience that they've had, Lord, reveal yourself as never before, we pray. And Lord, we'll reach out and take that. We ask, Father God, that you help and make us a witness. You've called us to be witnesses of what we've seen. We talked about what we've seen tonight, Lord. What was happening in us, may we be witnesses of that to someone else, of the risen Jesus. Lord, I ask that in the name of Jesus, you make this so, that anyone that's scared or afraid, that, Lord, they will step out in faith to know whom they believed in and are persuaded beyond the doubt that you're able. Beyond the doubt they have, dear God, that you're able. And we believe that, dear God, for each one that needs it tonight, that we will be witnesses as we go out into this area, all around where we are, Logan County and Bowling Green, and all around where we go, that we will be your witness with our words and our actions. We love you for this. Make it right. Meet every need. I know there's a lot of needs out there on the internet. We prayed for so many, dear God. And we believe that your word proves itself, and it will prove itself in lives time and time again. May your words accomplish everything it needs to do tonight, we pray. And we love you for meeting the needs in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 Everybody on the internet, we love you. We pray you stay warm and blessed. If you're watching us still in the cold, and God bless you richly. Let us know you're watching. We'd love to hear from you. We'll see you soon here at Christian Life.